Mike O'Mara, Radio Entertainment.
Hello, my name is Mike, and today's show is brought to you by our Amazon page. Please remember to shop at MikeOMaraShow.com/Amazon. It's quite simply the best way to support this show. If you need it, Amazon has it, and you can get it at MikeOMaraShow.com/Amazon. Bookmark it, please.
Available on demand every day in iTunes and the Google Play Store and around the world on MikeOMaraShow.com. What more can we do for you? It's the Mike O'Mara Show.
And the Greek Orthodox Church of Annapolis will be sponsoring their annual Greek festival. There'll be food, attractions for the kids, and plenty of fun Greek style. This is Bob White on Bay Country 103. Bay Country 103 reminds you that the Annapolis Seafood Festival is coming up not two weekends away. Your chance to get out and enjoy some of the fabulous seafood of the wonderful Chesapeake Bay with the Annapolis Seafood Festival coming up soon at Sandy Point State Fair. Park. Sorry. Bob White with you. 10 minutes after the hour, here's your Bay Country weather. Today, humid and cloudy with a chance of a thunderstorm late in the day. High temperature of 85 degrees. You're listening to The Bob White Show. Yeah. And now, here's Jive Bunny to play for you. Bob White. The worst disc jockey I ever hired at Bay Country 103. And now enjoy Chubby Checker to sing for you. This is Jive Bunny, right? This is
Jive Bunny. Bunny and the Master Mixers, if you want to be, you know, absolutely accurate, yeah.
Rob, for the for show historians, for people that like the history of broadcast, would you explain these type of records and what they really were all about? They were popular.
They're in not the race records.
What did he
people
say?
Would race to change the station.
Race records.
Yeah.
That's right, Oscar. They were back in the days. We were all flying Confederate flags. They were race records.
Well,
that's
Mike, if you would set your rock and roll time machine to the summer of 1989 when this was on the charts. This is a sort of an early version of like a mashup. And they would take very familiar songs and cut them together. The problem with this is that they're not the actual records that they've sampled. They're imitations that they've edited together. You know what
Bob
I think?
Bob White taking this time out to congratulate the Fredericksburg Police Department for pepper spraying an African American while he was in the middle of a medical emergency. Bob White. See that video?
See?
No.
Race
did
records.
Did you see that video of those mooks that were, I mean, look, the problem is not enough information out there yet, so I don't want to overreact, but I will tell you, if he legitimately was having a stroke and they pepper sprayed the guy sitting in his car because he wasn't responding to the command. So I just wanted to make note of contemporary news of the day, Bob White.
Hey, Bob, would you say that this song by Jive Bunny and the Master Mixer is sort of like a bastard grandson of Hooked on Classics and Hooked on Swing?
And yeah. Hooked on Classics was great when I was a club DJ because I could just put it on and you get all the hits and everybody would dance at the same. They'd all dance at the same rhythm, you know, like that. Hooked on Classics.
When Mozart wrote his music, did he have a track of people clapping in the background?
No, you know, last night they've got the big conductor school up here in Maine, and I refused the invite to join my sister and brother-in-law at the fabulous concert in the woods based on one fact. And this is sad for me, but unfortunately, I cannot deal with my ass hurting that long on those chairs. Pony, is everything all right? Is everything A-OK? Or are we having some issues?
Mike, they're not texting, so don't worry about it.
Oh, okay. That's good. Yes. Pony, give me a thumbs up because I get paranoid when I see your scowl this early on a Monday.
No, he's just fixing some software stuff.
Yeah. Oh, very good. Okay, that's exciting.
Continue, please.
Oh, Mike, here you go.
This is Hooked on Classics?
Hooked on Classics by the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. Very
hey,
urgent.
Everybody, welcome to Raffles 2. How you doing? My name's Mike. I'll be your DJ tonight. Huh? Don't forget your bartenders and your waitresses. Get outside and get out of the dance floor right now. Hey, just remember, 1 week from tonight, we're going to get the Thriller video. That's right. We're going to be the first club to have it in the greater Washington area at Raffles 2 in the Gaithersburg Marriott Hotel. You better come up here and see that. I didn't talk him up that much when I was a club DJ.
Hey, you know what would be bad is if you had this record playing, but you had your lights on the clapper. Your lights would just be flashing on and off and on and off.
Yeah. Right.
Now, do you want to make, Mike, did you ever play Hooked on Swing?
Oh, yeah. My favorite of the Hooked Ons.
The Hooked Ons!
My favorite, Rob, of the Hooked Ons was Hooked on Swing. No, I enjoyed this. I enjoy this because this is kind of like, you know, you had the right meter of in the mood. You know, as it's starting and then... Now, but what was the Jive Bunny was a different like,
yes, that came
artist
later.
That did that, this.
Yes, okay. Jive Bunny, Mike, I did some research. That was the second biggest record in Great Britain in the entire calendar year, 1989. The people of Great Britain loved Jive Bunny.
All right, let me tell you, the 80s were when music just slowly began its slow march into the abyss. Now, there are a lot of younger people that will disagree because they kind of love the 80s as kind of a nostalgic time, but really... Thank you, boys. Here we are.
Yes, now, Mike, you like Hooked on Classics.
This is a huge hit.
And you like Hooked on Swing. Did you also like Hooked on a Feeling?
Oh, now, this is different.
It's a great song.
This is a great song. I agree with my Bolivian counterpart over there. This is a great record. I can't
stop this. You only know this from the movie last summer, though.
No, Reservoir Dogs.
Is it in Reservoir Dogs?
Yes, and it's not a race record.
No, it's not a race record, Mike. As a matter of fact,
what is the one? What is the record? All right, calm down, Rob. What is the one in his brain right now? Rob's brain is going.
Let me
ask. Shut up, Oscar. Let a racehorse run.
All right, what is the one in Reservoir Dogs that plays when the guy is taking out the razor blade?
I believe. Give me 1 second. I think I can bring that up for you.
I completely am blanking on that particular song right now.
In the middle with you.
Yeah, it's Steeler's Wheel, Stuck in the Middle with You. But thanks
stuck
for keeping
in the
me,
with you.
Keeping the drama going, guys. Appreciate it.
And incidentally, an incredible role by that cop, that guy that plays the cop. I have no idea if he did any movies after that, but it was just, because he's like, why are you doing this? And then Michael Madsen is doing the thing where he's doing the little dance. Oh, my God, is that a great scene or what?
It's been a while since I've seen it, but isn't it a combination of cutting off his ear and pouring gasoline in it?
Yeah. He cuts off his ear, he pours gasoline on him, and then he's going to light him on fire, and that's when he gets shot by the guy that's already been gut shot.
Yes.
I think that's what happens. And then that guy's like an undercover cop, and then Harvey Keitel gets shot, and then everybody gets shot. Yeah. That's basically Reservoir Dogs. Everybody gets shot. That's
spoiler alert!
Oh, spoiler alert from a movie that's 100 years old. That's okay. Yeah. Hey, can I take one moment to, since we're all over the place at the beginning... I just like to say a shout out to our good friend Kevin McCarthy, who posted that interview, that brief interview with Tom Cruise. You know, I feel the same way that I did when I listened to Tony Perkins and Gary Stein interview Ringo Starr. The joy of that is their joy being with the celebrity.
Yes.
And you know what? That's been working for me. Mm. I think for years I was a cynical DJ and everybody. This was kind of a stern factor that we always thought you had to tear down the celebrity to make it entertaining. And I'm just here to say Kevin did this like little brief little question and answer with Tom Cruise in Austria at a film festival where the new Mission Impossible movie was debuting. And it just was so infectiously ass-kissy that I loved it. I loved that moment. I loved it.
You lived through his joy.
Well, yeah, and it makes me realize why Kevin McCarthy works for people, because there's a segment of the population that maybe once in a while, we've gone so full circle with TMZ and snark and all of that, that now Kevin's style is just a nice throwback to when you treated celebrities with a little kindness.
Yeah.
And I loved watching. You know, has anybody taken more hits in his career than Tom Cruise?
No.
I mean, that guy has been just lambasted for years, and what does he do? He just churns out entertaining movies all
hits,
the time.
Mike,
over again.
And BDK was there. Kevin McCarthy was there, just really having his moment and bringing out his ticket stub. And I watched that maybe four times because
cool.
I enjoyed it so much. It was just really, really cool. And I'm really happy for his success because it made me feel good. That's all I wanted to say.
Baby stepping.
That.
You know that Kevin and I have our past.
we've identified weekend, what that is. That's
as
like,
of this yeah. weekend, Mike, we are friends on Facebook.
Oh, wow.
Baby
so
steps.
Is this something where he reached out to you or you reached out to him?
I reached out to him, and I tell you what did it. You were very impressed with his picture with, or his footage with Tom Cruise, which was great. But when he posed in the actual scene from The Sound of Music where they did
Do-Re-Mi. Oh, that's what got you, you old queen.
I said, that is so cool. But you know
I
what?
Like that
but
too.
You know what? The thing is that he is a young, hip movie reviewer. But for him to take that picture and go to the trouble to pose it and shows that he appreciates that older movie, that to me was very cool. So, I mean, he had a tremendous weekend.
It was a great shot. What Rob's talking about, The Sound of Music, there's a scene where Julie Andrews is running up with all the Von Trapp kids, and there's this courtyard there in Austria, mm-hmm. and Kevin and his fiancée, that's his fiancée, I guess?
Girlfriend.
Or are they married?
Girlfriend.
Are they girlfriend? No, they're not engaged.
No.
All right.
Nothing new.
I'll have to ask him about that when we get him on the show.
Yeah.
What is it with these WJFK guys that just don't pull the trigger?
Well,
anyway, so, yeah.
They're all not you, Mike. But don't pull it three times.
Yeah. It's Russian roulette with you.
that was so just nakedly mean, Oscar. But anyway,
here you are, Mike, sharing in joy, and what's he doing but kicking?
He brings me right back to why I do this, because I'm a miserable, cynical son of a bitch. Okay. But you know what? The most cynical of us can take a pause for a little J.A.
J.A.
Little Julie Andrews.
I know.
See, you begin with Do Re Mi.
What a
Do Re Mi. Everybody.
Do Re Mi. The first three notes.
Realize this is a Thanksgiving tradition, a holiday tradition. At one point during the holidays, don't anybody make no comments. But I will tell you that we crawl into the giant queen size bed with Michael and the dogs and both of my daughters and my wife, and we put on The Sound of Music and we watch it in its entirety. That is our little holiday.
It is one of the greatest Nazi-themed musicals ever written.
I am surrounded by a-holes.
It's better than Cabaret. I guess The Producers is another Nazi-themed one, but this is great
true.
Because you know what? Those bumbling Nazis, Mike, they let them escape.
They're ridiculous, isn't it? Then they crawl over a mountain and they go to Vermont and they live their days out.
It's no big deal that a woman that promised to be married to God for the rest of her life just says, nah, I think I'm going to marry Mr. Von Trapp.
Well, did you see Christopher Plummer in that uniform? Dreamy with a capital DR.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
I'm still sad that Rolf never got a sequel. So we know what happened to him. So we'll see. Maybe he's in Argentina.
Well, we could go on and on. But we're not going to.
Oh.
We're going to start the damn show right now because I'm tired of this queen talk.
It's the Mike O'Mara Show. You can listen to the Mike O'Mara Show at www.mikeomarashow.com.
Stay tuned for an outstanding entertainment program.
It's the Mike O'Mara Show.
Let's get down to business.
From the entertainment capital of the world.
Billy, most of us here had you winning this early. Were you expecting such a difficult fight?
Yeah, I don't know. You can't expect anything. I was really looking forward to just showing up, walking the ring, and then having him fall on the ground.
Billy. Hey, Billy.
No, man, I mean, I expected a hard fight, you know. Put my family through a lot. By the way, Layla, if you're watching, go to sleep, baby.
Billy. Hey, Billy. Billy, you're 43-0, undefeated. Are you running out of
legitimate opponents? Can you say that again?
Yeah. It's impressive. But who are you going to fight? Who are you going to fight?
You know, that's really Jordan.
I think I know one. Me. I mean, all the fans around the world, they want to see it. I mean, y'all tell me, who else is there? Your crew knows it. All these beautiful people in here know it. I know it. I just want to know why you won't give me my shot.
All I want is my shot. I just want my shot.
I'm sorry. Who are you?
You know exactly who I am.
It's the Mike O'Mara Show. Mike O'Mara, Rob Spiewak, Oscar Santana.
And now, from his office chair, here's Mike.
We are coming to you live from the Cappy Fiverr studio in the heart of our nation's capital, Washington, D.C. This is the Mike O'Mara Show. On the air and online worldwide, the Mike O'Mara Show is a daily radio show and podcast with the greatest listeners on the planet because they get it. And if you are here, you do too. Our show today brought to you by Blinds.com. Summer is here, people. We know how hot it is. Yeah. And getting ready for the second massive heat wave of the summer on the eastern seaboard. And it's time to deal with the hot house and the awful summertime glare and all the heat. These are what we call the dog days. We're in them. Luckily, Blinds.com is here to help. You can beat the summer heat with cellular shades. Those are what I have at my house down in Florida, which, by the way, I spoke to somebody, one of my next door neighbors, and they said to me, What are those shades those are? We'll talk about that a little bit later on in the rain they're getting. Solar shades, they're available at Blinds.com. Exterior shades, your house will stay cooler and your electric bill will drop. Blinds.com has been helping folks for over 25 years and they have incredible design consultants that are with you every step of the way. Very, very easy people to talk to, easy people to deal with. They're extraordinarily friendly, and that alone is a rarity in today's business world. Call Blinds.com, and you'll talk to a real person with real advice. Blinds.com has it all, including free color samples, free shipping, and free stuff. I'm sorry, I just lost my place. Prices that crush store prices.
They do, Mike.
So easy to install, even I could do it. Plus, the SureFit guarantee. If you measure wrong, Blinds.com will remake your product for free, even if it's your mistake. Go to Blinds.com today. Start enjoying your home and patio without the annoying heat and glare. You'll see easy in a whole new light with Blinds.com, as seen in my kitchen and now also my bedroom with those cellular shades that I love.
Nice.
Because they're lightweight, too, and they block out all the glare. Yeah. Yeah, I love them a lot. Welcome to the show. Whoa, everybody. First question, and I got to get this out of the... I know you're going to hear something in the background. I'm going to stop talking and just listen.
All right.
Can you hear anything?
I hear the sounds of great potential comedy about to happen.
All right, good, because I've got my new wall unit fan up here in the BR.
Oh, you got an air conditioning unit?
Yeah, not an air conditioning unit. I got a fan. Get an air conditioning. I got a $24 fan. I did not get... Hi, Rofo.
Hey.
How you doing? Rofo turns like towards that main light in the studio, and I go...
Well, as you know, Rob Ford just arrived in our country. He came from his homeland on the Vesta in a box of his own soil. He doesn't do well at daylight.
No, yeah, don't hear the fan. Don't hear the
fan.
No,
it's nice. It's
good. All right, so I just double-checking because I know the other one was...
Can we see a shot of it?
Yeah,
show us.
Super. Yeah. It's Mike's biggest fan. Look at that.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that nice?
Yeah.
Nice work.
That is good
nice.
Job.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that bottle that you see underneath the lamp, that is gin.
Anyway. I thought it might be shine.
I like
shine.
Turning the slow pans around. Let's go to the other side. Let's see if we can see anything over there.
What's that in the... Are your boots on the floor?
The sweet wall.
You can see the boots?
A little bit,
those?
Yeah.
They
appear to be made for walking.
those are my desert boots that I have.
Oh, we've seen them. Boots. Yeah, that's right. You bought them when you were off buying your squirrel gun.
Yeah, I keep
crow gun rather,
don't I? Absolutely. So, welcome to the show, boys. I mentioned this over the weekend. I didn't mention it on last week's show because, believe it or not, woe is me, I didn't remember it. My sister reminded me that over the weekend, my dad would have been 100 years old.
Wow, so,
that is cool.
Yes.
Very cool.
Yeah, actually, Friday would have July 24th is his birthday, so he would have been 100 years old. So kind of nostalgic, just thinking about him and being up here where I see him all the time. But Dad, you realize, you know, that old clock on the wall sure passes fast, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Flies by.
Your post that you wrote on Facebook was beautiful, and I love the fact that you still associate where you're summering up there with your dad because it was such a big part of your lives together.
You can always make me sound like an elitist fuck. You know that? You really
no, I know.
Where I'm summering.
Right.
Yes, next to the Rockefeller estate. Yes, sorry.
Okay, let me rephrase it.
But in your mind, that's what you think.
Yeah.
It's just funny.
You're at the lean-to, and it's nice that you have the proximity.
I am from away. I am from away,
as I would
be referred to by people up here. I am reading a book now called We Were an Island, and that contributed to my nostalgia because it takes place from about 1949 all the way up through 1985. And this couple, they were from the Midwest, I believe, and he ended up getting a job with Lockheed Martin out in California, and they officially dropped off the grid. They did not want to be part of material possessions. They didn't want to be part of modern conveniences, and they wanted to commune with nature on their own, and they actually purchased an island for $7,500 in 1949. It was all the money that they could muster, and they put it together, and they moved lock, stock, and barrel to an island off the coast right here, right up around Down East, and
wow.
They lived for all of their days on this island, and they would only get supplies on the mainland by rowing a dory, which is, for those of you that don't know, it is an old-style deep V rowboat, and that's how they got to and from. Not even an outboard. They'd take tows from people. You know, lobster boats would tow
sure.
them out and back and forth. But it's the most incredible story about people. Can you imagine? It's one thing to do that now where, you know, we are so inundated with modern technology. They did this in 1949 and just said, you know, we'll want to get away from it.
You know, it would be less incredible if it had been just 10 years earlier. But mm-hmm. 1949, we were on the, you know, the precipice of modern technology.
Yeah.
Right.
Everyone
they
had
missed
electricity.
Out on TV.
Yeah, they did.
How dare they?
They must have really hated I Love Lucy.
Right.
I'm buying an island.
The thing about it is they had, neither one of you are old enough to track with this. This is going to be for 50-plus listeners right now. The thing that's cool is they had the typical names of that era that it seemed like all my parents' friends had, okay? Their names were Art and Nan Kellum. And so the thing about
I'm with you, Mike, though, because
there were so many names like Midge and Dot,
yeah.
And they had the one syllable names. At least nicknames were everywhere. My parents would have a
Nan doesn't have cable. Nan hasn't seen Lucy.
But you know, I spent so much time with my grandparents. I'm tracking with you. You never meet Earl or Blanche or
right.
or you know any of these people anymore.
Stan.
Carl Stan never shows up. No.
Okay. Here's some names. I can remember the first names of people. Okay?
Jeannie.
There were
two
Arts.
Syllables, Oscar.
I think
close.
My father. I think my father knew three Arts.
Really?
And of course they were probably all Arthurs. Nobody
yes.
wanted to be called
right.
Arthur, but there were three Arts. There was a Midge. I know that there was a Midge.
Tell me she was short.
I don't remember who they were. There was Dev. Dev was another
Boy
guy's
or
name.
Girl?
A guy.
Okay, Dev's pretty cool.
Dev is a good name.
You know, here's a name. I'll throw the whole name out there. My father, one of my father's best friends up here, was named Dev Digazaldi.
Maybe not so cool.
And if you look at Mad Men, they don't do that enough. They should infuse some of those 60s, 50s names
one
where they all
names.
Have these.
Yeah.
So it's all about these people doing this and truly a weird thing that they bought an island, moved out to it, and lived completely off the grid.
Can
which
you
is,
imagine being fed
kind
up
attractive,
with,
actually.
Fed up with technology in 1949? It's like, can you believe this? This phone cord covers the entire house. All I have to do is pick this phone up, and I can go in any room. That's incredible.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's the thing.
They would go nuts in modern times.
I think one of the reasons was this guy had an engineering background, and he worked for the military-industrial
right.
complex. He worked for Lockheed Martin, and they were responsible for creating the warfare devices of the day. You know, that's what he did. I don't know if he worked on the Manhattan Project with the bomb in World War II. I'm not sure. But he was knowledgeable about the military-industrial complex, and I think maybe that might have contributed to it. They had all sorts of theories about these people when they moved to an island off the coast of Maine. They were about 2 miles out, and the theories went anywhere from this guy was a Nazi spy in World War II, and that's why he escaped to this island, or he was a Russian spy,
mm-hmm.
or they had some sort of disease. You know, the one thing you learn when you come to small communities like this is that there's a tremendous amount of gossip, and a lot of that just gets blown wildly out of proportion, and it's just a fascinating story. But the thing that got me the most is here are these two people, you know, well into their 70s, rowing in the open ocean on this dory, and it's fascinating doing that.
An absolute true story. Do you know where the island is in proximity?
Yeah, yeah. It's got a weird name. It sounds like Afterbirth. The name is it's called Placentia Island.
Mm.
Placentia Island, and that. Well, no, it's all these French explorers, and then they hybrid the names.
Did someone eat the island?
Like eat the placenta?
There was
know.
A bigger island first. And then, yeah. then this island came about 2 hours later.
They harvested the stem cells?
They did. Nice. They're going to make little islands all around. Yeah.
Well, you know, it's something that captures your imagination.
Anyone living on it now?
I don't know. I have no idea. I haven't gotten to the end of the book, so I'm not sure what's happening with
cool.
that. There might be, but there were settlers before them. I think there were two separate settlements that, and the cool thing about the island is that people would be there in like the 1700s, and then they would leave, and the island would kind of take over, and there'd be no evidence of them. And that, yeah, there were tombstones out there.
Sure.
And then the 1800s, same thing, and you just see little remnants of the previous homestead. And I think, I haven't gotten to the end of it yet, but I think it's the same thing with this family. Art and Nan Kellum. I think that's what's going on. Yes,
quick
Oscar.
Sidebar, when Shan's father passed away, she found out that her father and her aunt, her father's sister, they own a part of a piece of the Katy Islands on the Potomac.
Okay.
And I said, you should go and see them. That was a year ago. She hasn't gone and seen them yet. It's been left to her, right?
Yeah, that's very cool.
So
that
there are these
cool
islands on the Potomac
with her name
in Montgomery County that are called the Katy Islands that her family owns, and they could care less about.
I gotta look that up. Hold on a second. I want to do that. Are we gonna take a break?
All right, take a break.
We'll take a break. We will come back with more fun and more thrills on the Mike O'Bara Show.
It's Tony and Gary.
Hey there, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Tony Perkins.
I am Gary Stein.
And on this week's episode of the show, Paul Provenza.
I love Paul Provenza.
Great comedian. Had the Green Room.
The Set List.
Yeah.
And he directed The Aristocrats.
Absolutely. Going to be great. Also, we play a little bit of Mitch Hedberg.
Great comic.
Listen to The Tony Perkins Show. Subscribe at iTunes and listen on the brand new Tony Perkins Show app.
The Tony Perkins Show.
Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show, brought to you by Sleep Number Kids Beds.
Yes.
I love it. I love my Sleep Number bed. It's just the best. You know that. I got an 85. Carla's got a 65. Those are our Sleep Number settings. Makes us sleep beautifully every single night. Last night, I had a Sleep IQ score of 92. It was fantastic.
Good job, Mike.
Well, now Sleep Number's transforming bedtime for the whole family. Introducing the Sleep IQ Kids Bed. This is the first bed that lets you know how your child is sleeping. I mentioned this to Mrs. O'Mara just the other day, and her eyes went wide. It's designed to adjust to them as they grow. Your kid's sleep is more important than you know. Studies show that well-rested kids feel more confident and do better in school, in sports, and in life. With the Sleep IQ Kids Bed, you know the quality and quantity of your child's sleep, and you'll know what adjustments to make so they can sleep even better. I've got a 2-year-old. We're not ready for it just yet because he's still in the crib, but I will tell you that sleep is a huge part of a child's life. Anybody that's been a parent knows that. I will tell you, this bed will tell you when your kids are asleep, when they're awake. The Sleep IQ Kids Bed does absolutely everything. Just in time for back to school, the Sleep IQ Kids Bed is the ultimate school supply. There's only one place you can find it, a Sleep Number store. Come in and see all the latest Sleep Number innovations to help your whole family sleep their best. Tonight, bedtime, tomorrow, the world. Discover the Sleep IQ Kids Bed at any one of the 475 Sleep Number stores nationwide. Find one near you by calling 800-511-0061. And be sure to raise your eyebrows and tell them that Mike O'Mara sent you.
Right.
Thank
on.
You. I'm looking at the islands in the Potomac River. There are tons of them, man.
Yeah. So apparently
they're in there, though. The Katy Islands are
yeah.
in there.
I would say it's this, cool. that when we briefly talked about Roshan, I said, look, you should take a trip to go see what the story is if yeah. you and your family own these islands. And she said her father had gone up years ago and said that, you know, they were no good because of the water levels and yada, yada, yada.
What makes an island no good?
Yeah,
I mean, there has to be some good.
Not inhabitable. Not inhabitable. It might be like a mangrove island down in Florida where the water is encroaching, or it might not be navigable. You might not be able to land. I don't buy islands, Rob.
You do.
You might not be able to navigate to it because it's got a rocky shoreline, or it might not have anything on there worth it. You might not
yeah.
be able to even lay out. You know, all islands don't have like little beaches with a blanket like the Professor and Marianne.
Well, that's
what I
was sort of envisioning. And that, you know, maybe Oscar and Katie Shannon could move to Katy Island and have a bicycle that powered the radio.
It may be made of placenta.
In that case, I'll definitely need flip-flops for the shore.
What did Crocs.
Crocs.
What
is it, islands or island?
Islands, a little grouping of islands. But I wanted to ask you, what did they live off on the island?
The island was, I believe,
didn't
over
have
500 acres.
Did it?
It was huge. It did not have electricity. They didn't need electricity.
In the winter, up there?
They had a battery-operated radio. They were very much well-read people. They were well-educated people. They paid attention to the news through the radio, and they would listen to Meet the Press on the radio.
Did they make their clothes on a loom?
No, they would buy stuff. They would go to town, and that's what they had the dory for. That was their lifeline. That's what they would go back and forth. But they didn't do it on a regular basis, and they weren't hermits. They entertained visitors. There would be people that would come out and visit them.
Search and
there
were people
that would, well, there were also people that would be...
So you alive? All right, good.
Thanks. Good to see you. There would also be people that would stop by and bring them stuff, you know, because they didn't really accept charity because they're... There are a lot of these mission vessels that go off the coast of Maine here for people that live on the islands that actually, you know, they make charitable donations to the islanders, but they didn't accept that. But they did take gifts from people, and they would barter, and they would, you know.
I was
going to
say, had they any income, or were they living off savings?
They bartered a lot. They lived off savings. They made everything. They built their house. They got their, you know, they bought supplies.
Sure.
They had some sort of money coming in, but it was money that they literally planned so meticulously to make it last all of their days. And they, I think one of their chief exports off the island was sheep manure. That's what a lot of people wanted. So it was kind of interesting.
And they were probably pleased to get rid of it.
So they had sheep. That's wild.
Yeah. Well, the one of the islands right up off the coast here that I used to hang out on and go out to on a regular basis had sheep on it up until maybe 25, 30 years ago. And we'd chase the sheep all over the island.
Is that all you would do with the sheep?
Yeah. Eventually they caught one, and he was late that night.
Man! I get my sheep, and I go, come on, squeal, squeal. Come on, let's go. Come on, sheep, come on. But I don't know. This weekend was a weekend of nostalgia for me where I was thinking about my dad. I was thinking about older people in the 50s and 60s and how they grew up. And you walk around an area that that you have history, and I feel incredibly lucky to be able to have the memories of people. I will walk by homes that have maybe been sold two, maybe three times to other people, and I will look in like a renovated garage where they've turned it into like something totally different, and I will see friends of my dad sitting there. I will actually, in my mind's eye, I will see people that I grew up with as a little kid that were here all the time.
That's
there was
cool.
one friend of my dad's, a guy named Lamar, that actually used to work in this workshop, and he was there constantly. Mm-hmm. And he wore like this Greek cap, and he was there all the time, and he was just a very funny guy. And of course they all smoked like chimneys around here, and I remember the cigarette would be going and you'd hear him kind of going and I see that guy. I see that. For some reason, I see him all the time up here. So this book just jogged a lot of memories about how people looked, how they dressed, what life was like up here. And it's a throwback. That's one of the attractions up here. It's a complete throwback, as you both know. You've been up here. You know what I'm talking
they
about.
They say that when you get older and you start to lose your memories, you lose your recent memories. But the stuff from your childhood and from a million years ago, that's the stuff that stays with you.
So are you saying that I have that this is the early throws of dementia,
Mike,
here?
You
is
heard every word I said. I never used the word Alzheimer's.
Yeah, that's
or
what
did
it, well,
I?
You didn't say, well, you know what?
No,
maybe
I'm
the time
about
is coming.
Many years from now, but you know, you see, you had a sort of amount of it's like it was hard for you to believe that you had such clear memories of your childhood. But I think those are the ones that really stay with you. And
maybe
things
did you ever think that maybe I retreat into these memories because of the fact that my son has arrived at the terrible twos as the poster child for the terrible twos?
No.
You know what? To be honest, Mike, I've found that threes are worse than twos.
I will tell you this, that I did not break out the old iPhone and record this, but there was, if you could picture a velociraptor having its feet amputated.
Wow.
That would probably be close to one of the sounds I got when I think it was Mama in a store and I was in the parking lot waiting with him and he was tired and it was a level that I was not familiar with and
nor comfortable and it's just, with Mike.
It was, oh my God, I can't duplicate it. I'm not capable.
Have you ever thought
sound.
Of throwing? You know, they have certain headphones.
Throwing myself off a cliff?
No,
yes,
no,
the
no.
answer would be yes.
No, no. They have certain headphones that engineers use near aircraft. Where you could have them in your center console, and when it breaks out, you just throw them on.
Yeah, here's the thing that's great about a kid. A kid will take you to the point of insanity, will actually bring you right up there when he's doing this. And, you know, at one point I may have been a bad dad and said, will you please quiet down. And that doesn't help the situation. And he's in the back. There he is. Yeah. That's it. Let's give that one. And he made it worse. I said, will you please quiet down?
You should.
He's cute.
And then in 5 seconds, he'll say something or do something where all is forgotten because he's just too damn cute. Terrible.
Or it's the Alzheimer's.
Could you give me the? Could you please quiet down? But with your if you were Seinfeld, maybe that tone will help him a little bit more.
Would you please calm down? I'm trying to drive the car here. You're sounding like a velociraptor. How can I function in this automobile driving the car with you making those sounds? You're driving me crazy. You're 2 years old and you're acting every day of it. I'm not ever going to take you to the diner again. If you want a blueberry pancake, you're going to have to behave better. That's the way it's going to be. You little son of a gun. And I want to use the other word. It's a negative word for women. No! I don't know. You're driving me crazy. Sounding like a creature from Jurassic Park. A movie that I haven't even been able to see because there are no movie theaters close by. For God's sakes, I have to drive an hour and 15 minutes to get my hair cut. It's ridiculous. I'm abandoned.
Anyway, crazy. Crazy stuff up here. No, he's fine. He's fine, but it's. I think I had that discussion with my wife. I said, I felt every day of my 56 years on a couple of occasions this weekend. We're in this one little place where we had a gift certificate, and it's called Cadillac Mountain Sports.
Ooh.
And it's it's everything it says. It's kind of like it's for people that mountain bike. It's for people that rappel. Uh-huh. It's for people that kayak. I pissed off the minute I walked through the door at this store because I am just not any of these people. You know, it's for little people with little hobbies, with little bodies that jump into little devices so they can do exercise.
When you
constantly.
Went in there, Mike, did the clerk come up and ask if you needed directions?
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's a no. Actually, you walk in and they say it with their eyes. The young little fit bastards that are in there, and the guy looks at me and his eyes say. What the hell are you doing in a store like this? So because it's up here and they don't have a lot of air conditioning, the doors are wide open.
Sure.
And he was looking at the kayaks, and you'll never guess what he was saying when he saw the kayaks. He said, boat, 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 boat. I said, it's right over here. Boat. I said, yeah, it's the kayak. Boat. I know. It's not a boat. It's a boat. I said, can you say kayak? He goes, boat, boat, boat. And so he's looking at the kayak, and now the difference between 1 month ago and now is that if I turn around for 1 second, I mean 1 second, he has the speed is,
wow.
I have had, now this is not, I'm not happy about this because I got to be a better father. I got to be a better parent. I am not proud of this, but I'll tell you what happened. On two separate occasions, one was right out here in my yard when I was shaking some friggin' Cheerios out of the car seat, and he was standing next to me, and I said, okay, we got all the Michael? And it's just vaporized.
Where
it's
was
like
he?
Was, I thought, on the Enterprise, for all I know. I mean, he had beamed up, and I looked around. I look left, I look right, and I literally don't see him. And look, we're not super close to a road, but we're close enough to a road, and I freak out. And I look around, and he is in the garage, like in a back corner of the garage. He covered, I estimated, probably 100 yards in 1 second. That's what, you know, it's just like, hi. So Daddy got the Cheerios out of you. Michael, where are you? So it freaks me out. And in the store, they had these double doors that were wide open, and this place
is doppel doors.
This place is right on the road, the major artery, and I mean tourist drivers. That they don't give a rat's ass.
Yeah.
They're not thinking about anything. And I was standing there, and he had my hand, and he pulled away from my hand, and then and I did a beeline for the double doors. And almost knocked him over because, I was controlling this. So it's kind of like going,
as I'm, you know, as my groin is pulling and I'm staggering. And, you know, I think Carla was like in the corner going, do these sunglasses look good?
But is he at the age where holding his hand even just gently has become an issue? Because he starts
It's always
with
been
this.
An issue for him. I mean,
he does like that.
Yeah, I mean, he wants to pull away. That's what they want to do. They want their independence. They want to pull away.
And this is going to sound strange, but this may be a good solution for you. Have you heard of a little device called Tile?
Tile?
Yes. So a tile is something you would have put on your keychain. They come in sticker form as well. Mm-hmm. But if you could put a little tile on little Michael, you could always have him.
Is that what like
proximity.
Receivers in the NFL use?
No, no. Well, they might use it actually now. That's actually a good point.
But it's stick'em, right? It's
yeah,
stick'em?
Yeah, yeah. But it's a Bluetooth GPS. So if you actually lose him in a store and he gets older, I'm not talking about it right now. But you know how when I was a kid, I used to hide in the middle of like clothes racks and like hang out.
Oh, I used to do that. You know, I the round clothes rack. Yeah. You go in there, it's like a house built of coats.
You like hang out,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So once he does that, you can find him faster.
Yeah, but my parents never looked for me, though.
There was a barn down here over the weekend that was a used bookstore. And by the way, parents, just a little look. If you're first-time parents, just a little heads up from me to you. Use the used bookstores, okay? You will get an incredible deal on children's books. You really will. They practically give them away.
Barn?
Yeah, it's a barn.
In
it's a
Maine?
Giant. Yeah. Why?
Don't you have history with barns in Maine?
What do you mean?
I'm not
what?
Mistaken. Is it,
are you
going to
be
talking?
You're not going to talk about the moment, are you?
The first moment?
Okay, stop it. I don't want to go there.
See,
I don't want to go. Stop that.
I mean,
please.
For one thing, that's normally something I bring up.
No. Sure, sir. Please, for the love of God, I swear to God.
They
I'll
sell
do,
books
I,
there
you,
now?
You, no, listen
that's
to me.
So
you,
great.
I will do anything, okay? I will do it. Please don't. Don't go there. There has been contact again.
What?
Yeah, but I don't want. No, I don't want to talk about it. I am not. Shut up, Rob. I swear to God, I will get on a plane today. I will get on a plane and fly down there. We're gonna take a break when we come back.
But a great deal on books, Mike.
No, this was down the. Not that barn. God damn you guys. Hate you. I hate you.
You
hate doing this show, and I hate all of you. Anyway, let's take a break. We'll come back with more fun. I want to talk about some new technology when we come back on the Michael Merrill. Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show. Hey, people, are you hungry? You know, the last thing you want to do after work is go to the grocery store. You work a whole day. You don't want to deal with that. And then have to get all the groceries out, do your own prep work, and put it together. But I think a lot of people use cooking as a form of relaxation.
Sure.
I know I do. But I've always wanted something like Blue Apron. I'd like healthy and inexpensive food that I can make myself. That's why you need Blue Apron. Blue Apron delivers fresh ingredients, and they give you the step-by-step recipes, and they prep everything, and it's all fresh. You make a home-cooked, fresh meal, and Blue Apron does all of the work for you. They even offer kid-friendly family plans so the whole family can cook and eat together. Each meal takes only about 30 minutes to prepare. It's absolutely delicious. It's healthy. It's cost-effective. Shipping is free, and the menus are always brand new. They won't send you the same meal twice. Blue Apron works with your preferences and your schedule, and they only use the best seasonal ingredients for incredible meals, just like you would find if you're going to a farmer's market.
That's right.
Or going to the grocery store. Try this. Thai chicken burgers, yes, as delicious as it sounds, Thai chicken burgers with hoisin mayo and potato wedges, simply delicious, and
Mike,
the kids will like it
you
too.
You put that hoisin mayo on the potato wedges, forget about it.
Forget
it is
about
so
it.
Good.
That's right. Incredible meals, and the quality and the freshness will blow you away. Blue Apron, it is a better way to cook. Check out this week's menu and get your first two meals free by going to blueapron.com/TMOS. Our treat, really, the first two meals are on us when you go to blueapron.com/TMOS. Get it today and enjoy yourself. All right, so just a throwaway really quick is we are in a, it looked like an old chicken barn or some sort of lengthy barn where they had maybe livestock that was converted into a used bookstore.
Is it like 3 miles, 3-5 miles past Ellsworth?
Yes.
Yeah, I've been. Yeah, I went there.
You've seen it.
You gave me crap for taking Robert to an antique store when we were up there, but we actually went. That place was great and never ending on all sides. It's huge.
Well, the second floor is all books,
right.
And then the first floor is like antiques.
Uh-huh.
Where, and I think sometimes when you get antiques in an environment where it's like they all have stalls, it's almost like a flea market.
Yeah.
I think the antique prices tend to be a little higher than they should be. But the books were up there. But at the same time, they're used books, and I see some book about a lobster boat. And I said, oh, this will be good for my kid. And I see that it's $6. Mm-hmm. I said, well, you know, these are used books, and... I walk up to the front. I didn't say this. I said it under my breath. Maybe I said it to myself.
Yeah.
But I walk up and it's $6. And I said, okay. He says, that'll be $6. I said, I'll give you $4 for it. And he looks at me with like he's totally disgusted. And he says, we don't discount the books.
Oh, what a dick.
And now normally I would say, oh, I didn't know that, and hand him the money. But no, the way he said that was just, I put the book down on the counter. I'm like, oh, okay, here you go. Bye-bye.
Good.
So
good for you, Mike.
Good.
Yeah. I mean, because he had a toot about that. And I mean, this is some book from 1965 that the guys got there. And it's not even vintage. So I did do that. But Michael goes upstairs on the second level. And this is, you know how long the place is, Rob.
It is the length of a livestock barn.
Yeah.
I mean, it's huge.
I can imagine.
Right.
Yeah.
And so he shot out of my hand again.
Right.
And then he is so far down at the end of this barn. And we say, Michael, Michael. And a lady who was looking at books with a kid said, I heard thumping in the back corner. That's always encouraging.
Thanks for the
help,
broad.
Yeah, I'm picturing a spiral staircase, and he's just going straight down it. You know, I don't know what's going on in the back. But I finally found him. And
what was he doing back there?
He was just he sprints. He likes to run. The length of this barn is huge. So running. That's all he wants to do at this age. He wants to be free. Doesn't want to be confined in a car seat.
Right.
Doesn't want to be confined in a high chair. Doesn't want to be confined, period. He wants to go all day long. That's what I'm dealing with now. So, you know,
whatever. You should foster that. You should get like little baby blocks like in track. And
right.
You should set him up so he's getting used to that momentum or that movement where you're actually leaning forward as you're racing.
Or a treadmill. Yeah.
Mike, I've seen kids on
treadmill.
Yeah, they really exercise them, and then they're tired for the rest of the day.
Yeah. Yeah, we do that with my dog.
A treadmill?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They have kid treadmills.
Seems a little sadistic, doesn't it?
No.
Not if he likes it.
Do you have a treadmill up there?
No.
Oh.
No. I did a mile and a half today, though. No, you laughed, but I did a mile and a half today. Did a mile and
yes.
a half, and are you ready for this? Jogged part of it.
Hey, look at you.
Let's not get crazy.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Oh, my God, the knee. Oh, my God, the knee. Help me. The knee is gone. I'm trying to find. Okay, here it is. This is technology today. I thought instead of all the nostalgia and talking about my kid, I would give you something that truly is interesting, and I think this would be very cool. One of the things up here in Maine and the infrastructure around the entire United States, you know what I'm talking about when they're talking about our roads crumbling, basically being so overused that they are crumbling. We've got it on Route 66 around here.
Oh, when I have guests in from out of town, if I have to drive them into the District of Columbia, I usually end up apologizing because of the way the infrastructure looks, just miles away from where the president lives. It's crumbling under your car. It's horrible.
Huge holes in the road.
Yes.
Yeah.
Here is the story. This comes to us from Climate Progress. That's a website I'm not familiar with, but I love surfing and finding these stories. So a Netherlands company introduces plastic roads. It's not a joke. Plastic
genius.
Roads
genius.
that are more durable and climate friendly than asphalt. The Netherlands is already home to the world's first solar road, or bike lane, technically. Now the country could soon be the first to use recycled plastic as pavement. It's just so neat when you see this kind of innovation. The idea for plastic roads comes from a company called Vocal Vessels. I should just say, the idea for plastic roads comes from Vokie. It's a Netherlands-based construction firm. According to the company, plastic roads would be a virtually maintenance-free product that's unaffected by corrosion and the weather. The roads could handle temperatures as low as minus 40 degrees and as high as 176 degrees.
Oh, look at that. And they don't look like rubber roads.
No,
they look like regular roads.
They tend to look like something from play school.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
I think it would be very, very cool. The idea came from after the company took a look at all the different road-related problems cities face, and then they came up with this idea. For contractors, asphalt is a great and sound product to build roads. However, contractors have to meet more and more demands concerning noise reduction, water permeability, and flatness. So that's what this is legit. It looks like these are real, and they're going to start putting them into the Netherlands.
The thing that is so huge that you read that to me is that they allow to expand and contract with hot and cold weather. Now, you live in a climate like D.C. that has very cold and very hot. That's what causes the potholes. And they, you know,
not a lot of detail in this article as far as what they're all about, but I'm just looking at the Netherlands has a bike lane that's solar powered for some reason. I don't know what that's about.
How would that
embedded with solar cells that are protected by two layers of safety glass. In the first 6 months of operation, the road produced it produces energy. Oh, so the road actually is a solar panel.
Yeah.
Look at that.
I mean, you got to realize this is good. You like this, Mr. Tech 411, right?
I love it.
Have you heard about plastic roads?
I've heard about plastic roads, but I haven't heard what you just said about plastic roads because I didn't know they're actually – I've heard – see, the technology's been around for a while, but implementing it has been so cost prohibitive, but maybe now they actually can try this. And the solar road was phenomenal as well because – really, you've got all this flat space, right?
Yeah, it's
you created energy. What I do have a question about is if we'll ever see it within our lifetime because of the cost of the roads.
And also, you know what? It would seem to be a better idea for new roads, but if you add in the removal of asphalt then replacing, that
DC,
might be where it gets you.
You won't see it because it would just cost too much to get through. I would say that maybe in a place like Nat Stadium and that whole area that's being rejuvenated, that's maybe somewhere they would put. They could possibly use this technology.
And they can make them red.
Yes.
They said the company is hoping to avoid some carbon dioxide emissions by switching asphalt roads to plastic ones. The carbon footprint of asphalt totals 1.6 million tons of carbon dioxide per year, the company says. So using recycled plastic instead could help cut down on some of those emissions.
I have, I'm glad you brought this up, Mike. I'm sorry. My car fell into what was, it felt like a trash can sized pothole right next to the Verizon Center in Chinatown.
Mike, I've seen this pothole. It has a gift shop.
Yeah.
This is a big pothole.
So I'm dropping off my my data modeling teammate.
Welcome to our pothole, Oscar.
Yeah, and
that's where they make the pot stickers.
And we were in Chinatown, and I drop him off at the metro, and I'm just making sure he gets to the metro. So I'm driving. It's like the type of cruise that you're looking to the left and kind of looking forward.
Right.
You've driven through a pothole again, Oscar. You've let me down.
I'm driving, and I go, boom! Yeah. And I'm like, oh, no. Pothole so big, Mike, that I got out in the middle of F Street right there in D.C. to go see the damage that has been done.
Ooh.
So
I think, you know,
if they could stop that, I'd pay all day.
Well, here's the bottom line. We know the facts that we do have to rebuild our infrastructure in the United States. You would want to have something that would last a long time. Up here, I've never seen anything like it. I've never seen anything even remotely like it. Roads that have trenching in them, that on a main drag when I'm driving around, that actually thrust your car in one direction or the other. I've never seen in all my years being up around here. The state of Maine is absolutely just wall to wall with horrible road situations.
The old days, Big Daddy told me that the ruts in the roads would be so bad in McLean, which is now
what are ruts?
Ruts are would be worn into the road by the tires or the wheels.
Since I've got it right here, let me explain what he's talking about.
Man.
You are sitting there, and it looks like the only way I could describe this, it looks as though on a super hot day, maybe they had one of these lumber trucks that was just too overloaded, and it trenched tire tracks into the road.
Man.
And I'm talking about 4 miles, not just 4 miles you have on either side. And if when you have uneven pavement, it's
exactly
the same concept. Yep. You've got uneven pavement that they've got up here. And I don't know what caused it. Because somebody said, well, winter causes these problems, but I don't think this would be a winter problem.
That has to be a heat issue, I would think.
Or maybe the way the roads were built in the first place up here.
Yeah.
It's just it's stunning to watch.
Rofo showed us a picture where it looks like the plastic roads are actually done in layers. And I can only imagine that plastic, being softer as a rule than asphalt, it would even be a smoother ride. It would have
some
absorption to it.
I'll show you the picture I've got here, and it's almost like it's got PVC. It's like it's a hollow.
Yeah,
exactly.
There you go.
I mean, that looks like it would have some shock absorption to it. Yeah.
And it's near Rotterdam, and it's right across from I Don't Give a Damn.
That's
where it is up here. So
and all the crazy colors you want. Do they mention what they're recycling the plastic from?
What do you call the people from the Netherlands? What do you call them?
Dutch.
The Dutch.
Yeah. They always pay for themselves in restaurants, Mike. It's just the culture.
Listen to Pony. Listen to Pony.
So stupid.
That's it. That's it. You've definitely found his humor. It's so stupid, it's funny. That's right. Yeah. The roads pay for themselves.
Do they mention anywhere in the article where they're getting the plastic to make it? If it's recycled plastic, which is great, because I'm thinking right away, shopping bags. How many people throw away shopping
bottles?
Throw them in a Dutch oven.
I know. See, I was thinking that one, too. All I know is when these roads are done, it's going to be quite a treat. But anyway.
Did they bring us the wooden shoes as well?
I believe we took them from them, but yeah, that's a Dutch thing, sure.
Dutch do that, right? The Netherlands.
Yesterday, they had a marathon on the Science Channel of how it's made.
Yeah.
And they show you how they make forklifts, how they make master locks, how they make wooden shoes.
How do they make wooden shoes?
I always thought that if I ever went to the Netherlands, I'd buy a pair of wooden shoes. That's what you do, right?
Sure, they're like the Crocs of the
1800s. Well, the Netherlands have given us one of the most hip cities in the world, the Amsterdam. I mean, that's the whole thing. The Netherlands, and they've also given us Yolanda Foster, right?
Yes, I believe so.
From the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills.
Yes. And,
so there's a machine that makes them. I always thought they were handcrafted, but
a machine
makes them.
Well, I imagine in the old days they probably
were handcrafted. Yeah, but they run out, like, I would say within a minute you could probably make 500 shoes, depending on how big the machines
are. That's 250 pair, Mike.
The Netherlands is a country in northwestern Europe known for its flat landscape, canals, tulip fields, windmills, and cycling routes. Amsterdam is the capital.
Yeah.
It's the home to the Rijksmuseum, Museum, Van Gogh Museum, the house where Anne Frank hid
and a red light district, canal side mansions, and a trove of works from artists including Rembrandt and Vermeer.
You know, we'd be remiss if we didn't mention our number one listener in the Netherlands.
Oh, yeah.
Lev Nedkov.
Oh.
How do you know this?
Because
Lev
is, you know what?
And Lev wrote in.
Appealing way. I don't think this is an insult at all. He's a nudge. He's very, very into everything we do, and he comments, and he's written us several times, and I love his name, Lev Nedkov. He's a disc jockey, a club jockey.
Really nice guy.
Hello, Lev. This is Mike O'Mara. I'd love you, Nev, to find a piece of plastic road and send it to us as a sample. Just like you'd find a little piece of pavement that was broken off. Can you send Rob, please, a piece of plastic road so
I tell you
we
what,
can look at it and smell it?
Let's barter like the people on Placenta Island. If he sends
Placentia.
If he sends me a piece of plastic road, I'll go down to O Street and I will send him a cobblestone.
Nice.
Yes, I will send him one.
Done and done. How do you know what street the cobblestone street is?
I drive up that road every day. And
do you look at that street and like, oh, the greater days?
No, I look at that street because you know what's cool about it is O Street, and I think there's a the problem is if you live on O Street, you have to go a full block to pee. But if you see it, they still have the tracks in from the streetcar, which is really cool because the streetcar used to traverse that.
I see those tracks, and all I think of is my rims. Like, I could not. Uh-huh. They're going to destroy my rims. Mm-hmm. I don't even know why they still have the tracks. They redid that road and put the cobblestones and the track back in. It's
because the streetcar's coming back, Mike.
Even if it's a walking area, you know what I mean? What are you doing? You're saying, hey, what a wonderful little toilet. Look back in history. Hey, ladies, come on down here and break your ankles.
No,
it's really
Mike,
a great idea.
It was funded by the
this.
People at Merchants.
At Merchants Tire and Auto.
Yeah, they just want you to have to come in.
Do you ever fantastic commercial for them.
Do you ever drive on O Street just for fun?
I have once, yeah.
Jeez.
Your soul is so old-timey that you took the cobblestone.
Well, but the thing is, he's driving a Chrysler product, so, I mean, they're all being, you know, they're buying back all their cars now, so what does it matter?
Mike, to be honest, I didn't want to drive on O Street. Someone hacked my car and made a turn.
Let me ask you this. Have you had any recalls on your car, on your 300?
No, not
so the 300 is doing pretty well, right?
It is. As a matter of fact, it's been one of the easiest to take care of cars I've ever had.
Except for that one time it burnt down.
No, that was different. Like, that was a different car.
Yeah, but a Chrysler 300.
Yeah, no.
Oh, no, it was the Tahoe, right?
No. The Chrysler that burned up was because they had mislabeled my battery leads, and I did a bad jump start. That's not on Chrysler. That's operator error. And one time
2008 to 2012, these Cherokees, they yes. are buying them back. I've never heard of that. I've never heard of it. In the history of recalls, I've never heard anything like that. It's pretty incredible,
and
isn't it?
Look for a sale on a lot of Cherokees in Cuba in the near future as they ship them down there to sell.
They're buying them back? Yes. I didn't hear this.
Yeah. They're actually because they are this recall and fines by the government. And
Is it because of that
amazing.
Hacking deal?
No, it's a separate thing.
Oh, my God.
You know what? I've got plenty of it. No, I don't. I have none of it in news you may not need coming up next right here on the Mike O'Mara Show. We'll take a break. Come right back.
Hey, Swanee, I was just on the O'Mara cast.
So was I.
How was it for you?
I found him to be gentle and giving.
What do you think about that fetish thing he has?
Oh, the one about TMOS?
It was weird. While we were doing it, he just kept asking me to call him the Jolly Man or the Latino.
When it was finishing, did he yell, Red Sox?
He kept calling me a P1. I don't know what that is. I think it's a category.
He asked me if I was up for the bonus show.
O'Mara cast. You can do it with Marcus, too.
That is a gross promo.
Yeah, when it was
don't play that one
me,
again. That made me really want
to
barf.
When it was emailed to me, I listened to it three times, and every time I had a different opinion of it. I just didn't know how it affected
Terry,
me.
Well, I know what my initial reaction is, and I'll tell you, oh, God almighty, I think I have to use the bathroom. We'll take a break. No, we're not taking a break. What am I doing? Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show. That threw me off. Wow. That promo was so disturbing. Please put it away. Bury it. Bury it in the backyard and cover it with lead.
I'll FaceTime you tonight. We'll have a promo burning.
Yes. Oscar.
That shook you.
Yes, it did.
You're like, whoa.
It's like equating listening or being on the O'Maracast show to doing it with Marcus.
Celine doesn't like it either.
Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show, brought to you by Touch of Modern. Remember the feeling of being a kid in a candy store or a toy store, surrounded by delicious stuff or fun things, each one looking better than the last? Now you can relive that excitement with the newest products and stylings at touchofmodern.com. You want to talk about a website where you can hang out and spend an afternoon just looking at unique and incredible stuff. We've all done it. It's touchofmodern.com. Go there right now. They connect directly with top designers for timeless and unique products. Really unique products. Stuff you will not see anywhere else. And that's kind of fun, too. Everybody's got that person in their world that they shop for, and it's like, well, I want to get him something truly cool that he wouldn't get anywhere else. Touch of Modern is the place to do that. They scour the globe for unique design-focused products. They've got tech. They've got iPhone cases. They've got vintage watches, new watches, home decor, men's fashion accessories, all the stuff they have at touchofmodern.com. And you'll love this website. Just surfing on
phenomenal.
It is a joy. You'll love it because they get the unique stuff. It's the one website that elevates your lifestyle with a single click. Right now, our listeners can get immediate access when they sign up at touchofmodern.com. That's touchofmodern.com. Do it today. Go through our website because tomorrow it'll be different. That's how life rolls in the fast lane. touchofmodern.com, everybody. We love it.
News.
Well, sad story. Kind of a bummer news today. Whitney Houston's daughter, Bobby Christina Brown, passed away yesterday. She was 22. She'd been in a coma since being found submerged in a bathtub back on January 31st. Of course, Whitney died in a similar way. Her death in 2012 was due to a drug overdose while she was in a bathtub at the Beverly Hilton Hotel. Just horrible. I don't know why irrationally I get pissed at that whole family. I don't know. I do too.
And you know what?
I don't know why. I don't want to judge. And they're in pain too, obviously. But man, I'm just, you know, Bobby Brown. You know, yeah, that's your wife, and now your daughter. I mean, God.
She's been in a coma for so long. I hate to say this. I don't want to diminish it, but eventually her passing away was a foregone conclusion. Everyone was sort of ready for it, but it still hits you hard because that's still just a kid. That's a kid.
22. The circumstances of her death still under investigation, although there's talk that her boyfriend Nick Gordon may have been responsible, but I haven't really heard any progress on that. The Houston family released this statement, quote, "She passed away surrounded by her family. She is finally at peace in the arms of God. We want to again thank everyone for their tremendous amount of love and support." So just a sad chapter in American music, really, when you start with Whitney and you end with the daughter. The WWE terminated Hulk Hogan and removed references to him from their website. Like I always said to Hulk Hogan, when you befriend a DJ...
Yeah.
Bubba the Love Sponge.
Which is odd because he's got such a classy reputation.
Yeah, the video surfaced of him saying racist stuff and using the N-word. It was a clip from a sex tape that apparently was, what, Bubba's wife being offered to Hulk Hogan?
Is that the phrase that I love down? That you see around is that one afternoon Bubba gifted his wife to Hulk Hogan.
Yeah,
that's nice.
Guy. Yeah, Hogan has apologized, said it's, quote, not who I am. All I know is this sex tape has been following around Hulk Hogan and really
forever.
Turned his life
I remember initially
down.
Seeing it. I think I don't know if we were on the radio. It was years ago. It feels
it
like
has, I think we were doing the podcast.
Yes.
But it did surface years ago.
And I was like, wow, that's a lifestyle Hulk lives. Like he's such a good friend. He's like, dude, you just got to bang out my chick, and then everything's gonna be okay.
Here's
right?
my wife. Yes,
yeah.
sir.
And if he just kept away from those racial slurs.
Yeah, right. And Hulk himself said, "That's unsavory, brother."
Of course, when you think of the wife of Bubba the Love Sponge, you might think. Clean?
Oh,
they're anyway, separated now. He's the, clearly.
Went, yeah, very much so. Oh, hold on. Wee, wee. Paltrow alert. Paltrow alert. ladies, your pelvic floor is a very important group of muscles, and Gwyneth Paltrow wants you to keep them strong. You know how you sometimes pee a little when you laugh, cough, sneeze, or do anything else that puts pressure on your bladder? I'm talking to the ladies now. I don't know myself. I pee all the time.
All the time.
Whether I'm laughing or not. A strong pelvic floor can help you prevent that. So how do you firm the pelvic floor up? Gwyneth, her Goop website, appropriately named sometimes, has some tips. Here's a good one. Try peeing in the shower squatting down. When you squat to pee as opposed to sitting up straight on the toilet. Do you think she's just trying to get noticed with this website?
Yeah,
it sure sounds like
I do.
When you squat instead of standing up, you automatically engage your pelvic floor. Ladies, furnishings, welcome to the pelvic floor. Pelvic floor, thank you very much. It naturally stretches and tones. Because your urethra is... I'm done. I'm going to throw up. I
thank you.
More of that.
You can find more, Mike, at goop.com.
Thank you, Gwyneth. We appreciate that. At least 46 women have accused Bill Cosby of sexual assault. 35 of them appear on the cover of the latest issue of New York Magazine. They're all sitting in chairs with the date of the alleged assault beneath them. Meanwhile, the Washington Post says Cosby used to get his quaaludes from a gynecologist. Apparently, this guy supplied recreational drugs to a lot of celebrities, but when he heard a story about Cosby using them to sexually assault a woman, he cut him off. The doctor died 13 years ago. One last note on Cosby. Spelman College is cutting ties with him. The school officially discontinued its William and Camille Olivia Hanks Cosby Endowed Professorship.
Man.
Jesus, that long enough? So it continues for Cosby. Ready for the box office this weekend?
Please.
Terminator number 10, Mr. Holmes number 9, Jurassic World 8, Inside Out 7, new Paper Towns. That's a new movie at number 6.
That's written
Southpaw.
By the guy who did Fault in Our Stars. Yeah, so it's another teen comedy.
5, Southpaw, also new. Trainwreck, Amy Schumer's movie at number 4. Minions
Boo.
At number 3. Pixels at number 2.
You're going to see that thing. You're going to see that thing fall quick because nobody liked it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And number 1 is Ant-Man. Did you get a chance to see it, Oscar?
My friend. I saw it yesterday. It was a lot of fun. It's not your typical comic book movie.
How come?
Can you do it tomorrow? Can we do a full review on it tomorrow? Because a lot of people are talking about
problem.
That. And have you seen Amy Schumer's movie yet?
I have
Has
not.
Trainwreck,
no.
And you know what? I think people expected that to do a little better, didn't they?
Yeah, I
Maybe
agree.
A little
yeah.
bit better?
I agree.
All right. It's unusual to feel disgusted before you eat McDonald's, but this is a pretty good way. Debbie and Hans Worth of Elk Grove Village, Illinois.
What's the name's out?
Went through a McDonald's drive-thru. Debbie and Hans Worth.
Yes. I want a cheeseburger. I want to get it in Rotterdam.
They went through a drive-thru. When they got home and unwrapped their cheeseburger, instead of finding their double burger, they found a wet rag.
Oh!
Yes, sir. So they called the store, and the manager told him to come in so he could give them a burger, but that made them upset since he didn't even apologize. Eventually, he did call and say he was sorry and was looking into what happened, but it seems like the Worths are done with this particular McDonald's. Not all McDonald's, though. Hans went to a different one the next night. Can you imagine going back to a McDonald's?
Dummy.
He ordered another double cheeseburger, and they actually served him the burger, not a wet rag. So thank you, Hans.
The problem is that there was only one wet rag, and it was supposed to be a double burger. If they had doubled up on the rag, then at least it's something.
But I think the wet rag was actually my wife.
Anyway. Here's a little something something. 62-year-old Marilyn Perry of Bellevue, Ohio, was driving last August and slammed into a 50-year-old woman named Pamela Beckham. Pamela wound up with a broken neck and several other injuries. Marilyn was arrested for vehicular assault. At first, the cops thought she'd been talking on the phone or driving drunk, but in court last week, they found out what really happened. Marilyn was praying while she was driving.
Mm.
Yes, her attorney says she's been going through some personal problems, and sometimes she would bow her head and pray while she was driving. Duh.
That's
no good. The judge believed her. He gave her 3 years of probation and ordered her to pay Pamela $10,000 in restitution. Pamela's husband says they're not buying it because Marilyn never even checked to see if she was okay. And, quote, church-going people are better people than that. I just wonder if she had one of those fishes on her car. You know, aren't those the things that say you're
yeah, like the
Lord?
God, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I know. I'm sure she had a co-pilot, guys. Thank you. We'll take a break. Come back with the Audio Vault and Rob Spiewak right here on the Mike O'Mara Show.
Here at the More Network, Joe, I like to think that we're more than just podcasters. We're superheroes.
Yeah, we're like the Avengers.
Obviously, Michael O'Mara, he's got to be Captain America. He's our fearless leader.
And Oscar Santana would be Iron Man. He loves technology.
No doubt about it. Now, I happen to have seen Rob Spivak with his shirt off. Dead ringer for Thor.
And, of course, the Hulk. Got to be Mermelstein.
You won't look amazing. Rob and Joe Show. New episode every week. Subscribe on iTunes and check us out on the TMOS app.
They are funny boys. Rob and Joe. Great show. Check it out, please. We love having them on the network. Hey, it's available. It's open mic, the audiobook. You're buying it. We're loving it. Listen to the story of the Mike O'Mara Show as read by the authors. Thank you, thank you, thank you for all the kind words about the audiobook. You know, we do a project like this, and sometimes we don't even realize that people are going to get so into it, and we're very, very excited about it. It's really terrific. Yeah, Rob.
One of the greatest things about it is we recorded it oftentimes with other people in the room with us,
yes.
And there's some pretty good moments that happened that were captured on tape. Here's one of my favorite Oscar moments from the audiobook.
Resurrecting the Mike O'Mara Show as a podcast was my idea. I called Mike multiple times. I stalked him. I mentioned it to Mike when he was leaving the radio station for the last time, and Mike didn't bat an eye. After a few weeks, I decided to call Mike and talk about it. He was writing out a non-compete clause from WJFK, something I didn't have.
Something I didn't have. There was urgency in my decision making. Yeah. Anyway, get the audiobook, only $6.99, now available. Download it instantly on iTunes or at MikeO'MaraShow.com. Open mic, the audiobook. You'll love what you hear, and we'd love you to get yourself a copy of it and help with our summertime fundraiser, ladies and gentlemen. We'd really like that.
Please.
Without further ado, let's open up the audio vault for today, Monday, July 27, 2015.
Last night, Mike, the premiere of I Am Kate, Caitlyn Jenner introduced herselves into our lives and said,
hey.
So did you watch it?
No, I'm sorry, I didn't. After all that nice talk about her, I didn't watch it.
I watched it, and it left me sort of conflicted because it was a heavy dose of Kardashian style programming, particularly up front.
It was tough.
But at the end, they really went strong. She visited the family of a transgendered kid that had committed suicide. And went to a balloon release. It was very sentimental. They actually did a PSA announcement at the end. And I think that there is still the chance that this show is going to use Caitlyn Jenner's story for good. But
well, get away from that Kardashian crap.
Yeah, it was
you're
tough up
kill
front.
The show
because
yeah,
you're
you
like, what's going on here?
Yeah. Knock it off.
As an example of the Kardashian styled stuff, here's Caitlyn playing tennis with her sister.
Now I know why girls need a sports bra. When you start running, it gets a little tougher, doesn't it?
Yeah. Get in.
The hair got in my eyes again.
Bruce was a lot better tennis player than Caitlin is.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was fun.
Yeah, it was fun. It was fun.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, as a special feature of the Mike O'Mara Show, I think the time has passed long enough where we will present famous quotes of the day delivered by Caitlin Jenner.
Okay, very good. Caitlin.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Thank you. Thank you. We'll have another one the next time she comes up on the show.
Mike, I like when you make hay when the sun shines. And speaking of hay.
Hey!
Do you still take all your news, Mike? Do you still get all your news from WKBN Ohio?
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. Every day. Every day. I'm just feeling guilty right now.
I don't know. Let's just move on.
Can't help myself.
WKBN had an arson that they were reporting on.
Mm-hmm.
And I think what's funny here is the way the reporter reacts to the matter-of-fact answer they got. They're trying to figure out why a house was set on fire.
Do you know how this fire started?
Yes, I do. It was because of my cousin. And I don't want to mention no names.
Your cousin?
Yes. He's mad because he can't get with me. I'm married to my husband. It's a long story. Just make it short. Yeah. He already put him in a hospital once last month, and he figured he's going to do something else to get back.
All right. So right now, the fire has been put out. Thank you for the information here. That's the latest here live in Leavittsburg. Derek Lewis, WKBN 27 First News.
So the fire,
so
Mike.
He literally has an arson scoop, and he can't escape from the interview quick enough. That ballless dink. Well, unbelievable.
Mike, the fact that they're the basis of this arson is the fact that, you know, a cousin wants to bang his cousin.
Ladies and gentlemen, as a public service on the Mike O'Mara Show, we now... Oh, you guys froze up on me. Can you hear me?
Yeah,
we can hear you
great.
Just fine.
Yeah.
Okay, and now brought to you as a public service... the news of the day, delivered by Caitlin Jenner.
Hi, it's Caitlin
today,
Jenner.
The actuality quote of why the cousin wanted to light the house on fire.
Here she comes.
Because she wanted to get with him.
Thank you.
That was great.
Was
hey!
Oh, so if you're not taking your news, Mike, at WKBN, maybe you're watching News 2 in Nevada.
Oh, and, of course, all the time.
And do you remember, I guess it was a couple weeks ago, when Amazon had their new big midsummer sale?
Oh, yeah.
And Walmart tried to compete with them?
Yes.
It turns out that Amazon actually outsold Walmart, and this anchor, with great enthusiasm, explains why, much to the discomfort of his partner.
The bump for Amazon came after it reported an unexpected boost in sales in its second quarter. Amazon earned $92 million last quarter. That's a 20% jump in sales compared to the prior year.
You know why? Because they sell sex toys, and Walmart can't or won't sell sex toys. Does. A friend of mine works in the warehouse. He says they sell a ton of them.
Yeah.
I'm just telling you how it is.
Wow.
You're trying to eat breakfast.
Well, yeah, wow. But nobody else will tell you this, but that's the reason.
Well, a friend of his works in a sex toy warehouse, Mike. It's a friend.
Wow. Wowzy woo woo. That's scary.
That'll make you say scary.
Hey.
Mm-hmm. President Obama, Mike. They had, is the rapper named, is it Wally?
Wale.
Yes. Forgive me. They had a great summit for 130 kids where they were telling them the importance of going to college.
Mm.
And of course, you know, Wale was there to rap for the kids, and the president and Mrs. Obama were there. President Obama admitted, now we saw this weekend, he can dance. He was dancing this weekend.
Yes.
He was great. But Mr. Obama, the president, President
yes.
Obama, I'm trying to do better, Oscar, for you.
You're fine.
Calling him President
Appreciate
Obama.
That.
Only the last year.
He says...
So it's out of office.
Yes, right. We're going to close strong, I promise.
Hey!
President Obama says he cannot rap.
My rapping skills are terrible. That's one thing I can't do is rap. I like rap, but I cannot rap. Although I have enough of a rap that I got Michelle to marry me, though. I'm just saying.
Very cool. Mike, have you ever seen a caddy get fired during a tournament?
No, I've seen caddies get dressed down a lot, but I've never seen a caddy get fired.
Robert Allenby, I believe this was the Thursday round at the RBC Canadian Open, got mad at his caddy, fired him, and was actually carrying his own bag. A guy in the gallery, Tom Fraser, saw this and got to caddy for Robert Allenby for the final nine holes. Here's
Robert
Tom.
Allenby's had some issues. I mean, isn't he the guy that got beaten up at one of the tournaments?
Right?
Hothead,
right?
So, yeah.
He said that he was robbed, but apparently he wasn't, or he was drugged. Who knows what happened? Why?
Yeah, but definitely a lot of controversy
with
this guy.
At a rum scary. Bar. Anyway, very so here's Tom Fraser saying that, I got to caddy for nine holes.
He was carrying his clubs and his caddy bib, and I thought it kind of odd. And I thought, well, maybe his caddy's in the restroom or something like that. And
guy
then he started
loaded.
Talking to an official where he's saying the caddy left him, and he's there with the situation. So I just raised my hand up, and I said, oh, I'll carry your clubs, Robert. And my buddy said, he's a golfer, and, well, not a very good one, but anyway, so, and then he said, yeah, come on in. The one greenside bunker he was in, he took the lead and raked it himself.
See, that's him being Canadian. Well, yeah. So, you know, I'll just help him out.
Oh, yes. Yes, and, yes.
And, Mike, we close with a bipolar Japanese deer. Here are two sounds that a deer knows how to make. I didn't know that deer made noises at all. It starts friendly and gets kind of ugly. Nice, right? Kind of cute.
It's cute. It's very, very cute.
But this is a bipolar deer, Mike.
Oh, it's going to get upset pretty soon.
Yeah.
No. No.
You got to play that one more time, Rob. Just one more. Please play that. Okay, this is the sweet part.
Oh, yeah. Aw, Bambi. Sweet. Little white dots on his back.
This is so cute.
Adorable.
All right, everybody, listen up.
Uh-oh. And that's when I had to go to my dry cleaner. That is your magic audio ball, nice. Mike. Have a great Monday, everybody.
That's it. Another Mike O'Mara show has come and gone. A little sooner on video than I wanted to. Be sure and join us again for more fun and more thrills at MikeO'MaraShow.com. If you want to correspond with the Mike O'Mara show with a letter or package, send it to TMOS, Box 2796, Leesburg, Virginia, 20177. To get your message or birthday request into the Wednesday mailbag, email Rob with two B's at MikeO'MaraShow.com. The Mike O'Mara Show relies on your word of mouth. Tell a friend or family member about our audiobook and the whole show, and make sure they get it too. For Rob Spiewak and Oscar Santana, Mike O'Mara inviting you to join us again for another episode of the Mike O'Mara Show. Bye-bye, everybody.
So long.
Ciao, ciao.
Whoa, wait, don't go. I need to tell you that MikeO'MaraShow.com/Amazon is perfect for all your online shopping needs. Shop the best way. Shop Amazon. And please go through our website, always open at MikeO'MaraShow.com/Amazon.
Hey!
Mike O'Mara, Radio Entertainment.